One of my most popular videos is my video on the Composite TV Signal. It is kind of an obsolete technology, but people seem to enjoy learning about it. So I have decided to make a follow-up video where I'll go into more depth about the vertical blanking interval. You see, I never really offered much of an explanation of it, and some of you may be wondering why we have equalizing pulses, why some pulses are inverted, and what's the difference between the equalizing pulses and the vertical sync pulses. Welcome, I'm Dr. Plague, and today I'll try my best to help explain what happens during the vertical blanking interval. In this video, we'll be looking at interlacing and how a TV detects horizontal and vertical syncs. I'll be showing some real examples of composite video signals, and I'll build some simple circuits to help demonstrate the concepts that I'll be talking about. By the way, if you haven't seen my first video on the composite TV signal, then please go back and watch it. I'll place a link in the description. This should be a fun and interesting video for those who are interested in the composite video signal, so please stick around. So first, let's look back at my previous video, and this is what I defined as the recipe for an NTSC composite video signal. By the way, this video will be concentrating only on NTSC video signals, but other formats such as PAL may be similar, but no guarantees. These two sections each make up a vertical blanking interval. We have 6 equalizing pulses, or EPs, followed by 6 vertical sync pulses, or VSPs, 6 more equalizing pulses, and then some blank lines. Each of the EPs and VSPs are at twice the frequency of a standard line. Let's take a look at these on an oscilloscope. What you will be looking at is a composite video signal from an old VCR. Here's the start of the even fields with the half lines, and back to the odd fields. These are the pre-equalizing pulses, here are the vertical sync pulses, and these are the post-equalizing pulses. As I mentioned in my previous video, it is the vertical sync pulses right here that are responsible for sending the electron beam from the bottom back up to the top of the screen. So, why do we have these equalizing pulses? To explain that, I'll need to talk some more about the sync pulses and interlacing. First, let's talk about how some old analog TVs used to detect sync pulses. We're going to need a little understanding of calculus for this. But don't worry, we won't be doing any math. We just need to understand a couple basic concepts. We need to know what a derivative is and what an integral is. Let's look at a derivative. Let's say we have some function f of x, and it looks like this when we graph it out. The derivative f prime of x is simply the slope of our function f of x throughout the entire graph. When the slope is flat, we call that a slope of 0. And when the slope rises 45 degrees, we call that a slope of 1. Similarly, if it falls 45 degrees, we call that a slope of negative 1. If the slope becomes completely vertical, then it is infinite, etc. So, if we look at f of x, we can see that it starts out with a slope of 0. We gradually increase to a slope of 1. Then we come back to a slope of 0. After that, the slope starts to drop to negative 1. Then comes back up to a slope of 0. So, if we connect the dots, we end up with something like this. Now, how about an integral? This too is fairly simple. We'll start again with our function f of x. Now, the integral f of x dx is simply the area under the curve. If we start adding up the area under f of x, going from left to right, we'll end up with a graph that looks something like this. Let's think of f of x as a graph showing the voltage of a signal versus time. Now, let's say we send that through some type of electrical circuit, and that circuit outputs an altered signal. Specifically, we want two different circuits. One that outputs the derivative, and one that outputs the integral. This is actually very easy. We can use a high-pass and a low-pass filter. A high-pass filter will give us the derivative, and a low-pass filter will give us the integral. Bear in mind that the output from a low-pass filter will decay over time, so it won't give us a perfect integral, but that's fine. We don't want it to be perfect. We'll call the high-pass filter a differentiator, and the low-pass filter an integrator. Keep these filters in mind. We'll come back to them. Now, back to how to detect sync pulses. Let's look at one way to do it, and for this, we'll need a little black box. This little black box will contain some type of circuitry. We don't care what it is or how it works, just so it provides us the proper results. What we want is for it to take an input, in this case, it will be a composite video signal, and it will provide an output. Specifically, the output will be an inverted version of the sync pulses from the input signal, and I'll make it a 5-volt logic level output. So, if we have a composite video signal like this at the input, the output will keep just these negative pulses and invert them using 0 and 5 volts. I'll call this a sync separator, since it separates the sync pulses from the composite video. By the way, I did design and build a very simple version of this black box sync separator right here. It consists of some op amps, a diode, resistors, capacitors, and a Schmitt trigger logic IC. Remember back to my previous video where I said that most TVs will be somewhat forgiving and allow you to send a composite video signal shifted up in voltage? In other words, you can have a slight DC offset to it? Well, this circuit that I designed will also be forgiving and allow some amount of DC offset. Also, it will allow for a slight variance of signal amplitude. I'll probably make a separate video where I show you how I designed this circuit and how it works, but for this video, we don't need to know that. Now, another thing that a sync separator can do is to separate the vertical sync pulses from the horizontal sync pulses. So, how can we separate the vertical from the horizontal pulses? Let's first look at the vertical sync pulses. Remember back to my previous video where I mentioned that vertical sync pulses have about a 92% duty cycle? Well, when they come out of the black box, they'll look like this. They are much wider than the standard horizontal sync pulses. The standard horizontal sync pulses will look more like this. See the difference? Not only are the vertical sync pulses wider, but there is more area under them than there is in the standard horizontal sync pulses. If only we had some way to determine the amount of area under the pulses. Oh, wait, we do. Remember back to our discussion about calculus concepts? We said that an integrator would add up the area under a curve, or in this case, we're talking about pulses. So, all we need to do is to add an integrator to the output of our black box, and keep in mind that an integrator is simply a low-pass filter. All we need to create a simple low-pass filter is a resistor and a capacitor. I'll just choose some common values such as 1k ohms and 0.1 microfarads. Now, the longer a pulse lasts, the more charge that will accumulate across the capacitor. When the pulse goes low, the capacitor will slowly start to discharge. So, we need multiple vertical sync pulses to charge up the capacitor. So, remember we talked about having 6 vertical sync pulses? Each pulse will charge up the capacitor to some degree, and the time between the pulses will cause the capacitor to discharge a little. So the 6 pulses will give an output from the low-pass filter that looks a little something like this. Then, after the vertical sync pulses are finished, the output will discharge and look a little like this. So now, let's send a real composite video signal into my sync separator circuit and take a quick look at the vertical sync pulses coming out of it. The yellow trace, which is channel 1, shows the 5-volt signal output from my black box, and the blue trace, or channel 2, shows the original composite video signal. Do you see how it keeps just this portion right here and inverts it? Now, this little circuit that I built isn't perfect, but what do you expect? I built it on a breadboard with generic parts, so we're not going to get the best output, but this should be good enough to demonstrate the basic concepts. Now, let's add in the low-pass filter with a 1K resistor and a 0.1 microfarad capacitor. Let's send in the composite video signal and take a look at the output. Now, we can trigger off channel 1 and pick any voltage level we want to simulate a vertical sync detection. And if we look at the frequency of the pulses, we can see we are very close to 60 Hz, which is what we would expect. Actually, 59.94 Hz is exactly what we want for a color signal. And this is what the pulses look like as we zoom out. Next, let's look at the horizontal sync pulses. How can we detect those? Similarly to how we detected the vertical sync pulses by using a low-pass filter, we can use a high-pass filter to detect the horizontal sync pulses. The high-pass filter is a differentiator, and it looks at the slopes of a signal. The sync pulses have 3 different slopes. They have a slope of 0 when they are flat, they have a very positive slope when they rise up, and they have a very negative slope when they fall back down. So, sending the output of horizontal sync pulses from the black box into the differentiator will give an output similar to this. The positive spikes correspond to the rising edges, and we could use those to trigger a horizontal sync. But notice that the vertical sync pulses also rise up, so they could also be detected as horizontal sync pulses. So, is this incorrect? No. The vertical sync pulses also serve as horizontal sync pulses, because if they didn't, you would send the beam right off the right edge of the screen. Just like with the low-pass filter, we can also build a high-pass filter with just a resistor and a capacitor. Just swap them around. Again, I'll choose common values, 1 nanofarad and 1 K ohm. Let's add this to my circuit. Now, I'll add a 3rd channel to the scope and show you the horizontal pulses in pink. Perfect! You might want to process these a little bit to get some nice output signals, but this gives you the basic idea on how we can separate these signals. So now, what about these equalizing pulses? Why do we need them, and what are they doing? Well, to understand that, we need to look at what's happening when we have an interlaced image. Remember, an interlaced signal draws a complete image in 2 passes. The first pass draws only the odd-numbered horizontal lines, and the second pass fills in the even-numbered lines. What causes the interlacing is the half lines here. The half line before the pitcher in the second field serves to waste enough time for the electron beam to move down halfway between the lines in the first field. And the half line after the pitcher in the first field helps to balance out both fields. the equalizing pulses are needed to help create an interlaced image.
Wait a second. I thought you said the half lines create the interlaced image. I'm confused. Which is it? The equalizing pulses or the half lines?
They're both needed. Actually, there are several things that help out with the interlacing, such as the double frequency of the equalizing and vertical sync pulses, which I'll talk about a little later. Since we add a half line before and after the vertical sync pulses in the second field, that allows that vertical sync pulse to be generated one half line sooner in the second field than in the first field, relative to the starting position of drawing the image. This is what creates the vertical offset between the two fields. The half lines are the main ingredient, but the equalizing pulses help to smooth everything out. Let me show you why this is. Let's look back at the output from the integrator. Notice that during the horizontal sync pulses, the capacitor in the integrator starts to charge up slightly, and by the time the full lines are complete, the integrator has had a chance to discharge its capacitor. But look at the half line before the first equalizing pulse of the second field. See how it doesn't discharge as far down as it does after a full line? Let me draw this out to help exaggerate it for you. Let's say the capacitor discharges completely after a full line, like this. Then the half line comes along, and by the time the half line is finished, the capacitor has not fully discharged yet. If we didn't have the equalizing pulses, then the vertical sync pulses would start charging the capacitor when it already has a partial charge on it. This means that it won't take quite as long to charge up to the level that we are using to detect a vertical sync pulse. Now, during the first field, we didn't have a half line before the vertical blanking interval. Instead, we had a full line. So, if we didn't have the equalizing pulses, then the capacitor would start charging from a fully discharged state. Notice that now the vertical sync pulse would take a little longer to get to the point where we detect it. So, without the pre-equalizing pulses, the even-numbered lines wouldn't be drawn exactly in the middle between the odd-numbered lines. The pre-equalizing pulses exist to help discharge the capacitor to the same level in both fields before the vertical sync pulses start. The post-equalizing pulses serve to help discharge the capacitor after the vertical sync pulses have charged it up, which isn't as necessary as the pre-equalizing pulses, since replacing the post-equalizing pulses with extra blank lines would also discharge the capacitor. Now, I have a little video circuit that I designed that outputs a composite video signal, and I can alter that signal to help demonstrate this concept to you. I have removed the pre-equalizing pulses and sent it into my sync separator circuit, and I'm triggering on the charging of the capacitor, which is channel 1 in yellow. You can see how there is a lot of jitter in the vertical sync pulses compared to the horizontal sync pulses, since each field is slightly off time from each other. Actually, the reason the horizontal pulses appear jitter-free is because every other one belongs to a different field, odd and even. Later, when I add the equalizing pulses in, you'll see that all the jitter will improve. Now, if I single trigger this, then you can see that there are no pre-equalizing pulses, and instead, either a full or half line leads directly into the vertical sync pulses. Now, if we line up the ending of a full line with this vertical graticule line right here, and we single trigger on this a few times, you'll notice that this moves forward a little bit when we have half lines. See the small difference? We've triggered a vertical sync pulse in slightly less time after a half line as opposed to a full line. Now, I'll change my video circuit to include the pre-equalizing pulses, and we'll try this again. The first thing you will notice is an improvement in the amount of jitter in these locations. Now, remember, my circuitry is on a noisy breadboard, so this won't be perfect. I need to shrink this a bit, and line the trace back up to a vertical graticule. And we can see we have full and half lines over here. But notice that they all trigger at approximately the same time now. So that should help to demonstrate why we need equalizing pulses. By the way, if we were using a progressive scan instead of an interlaced scan, then we wouldn't really need the equalizing pulses, would we? They wouldn't hurt anything to keep them in, but they wouldn't be necessary. Now, let's talk a little about the double frequency of the equalizing and vertical sync pulses. We can refer to these double frequency pulses as serrated pulses. So, why do we serrate these pulses? Why not just keep them the same length as full-length lines? You see, we do it to keep a steady stream of horizontal retraces. Specifically, we need this because of the half lines we inject for the interlacing. Let's look back at the transition moving from field 2 into field 1. To keep a steady frequency of horizontal retraces, we can ignore the mid-serrated pulses and trigger on the horizontal sync pulses at these locations. Boom, 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 boom. So, here, we really don't need the serration. But if we transition from field 1 into field 2, then, due to the half lines, we hit the opposite serrated pulses like this. Boom, 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 boom. Notice that this creates equal time spacing between each horizontal retrace. Without the half lines, we would trigger on these pulses. So, you may be asking, if we didn't really need the serration during the transition from field 2 to field 1, then why serrate them there? Well, we really want to keep both of those vertical sinks the same so we know we're charging that integrating capacitor exactly the same each time. Another question that may pop up is, how do we ignore the unneeded horizontal sync pulses? Well, to understand that, let's look at one way we could trigger a horizontal retrace. Let's say we have a voltage that ramps up from some value, let's say 0, to somewhere north of 100 volts. And I'm making these voltages up, just for illustrative purposes and to get the point across. Now, let's say that this voltage moves the electron beam from left to right on the screen, where 0 volts puts the beam on the left, 50 volts puts it in the center, and 100 volts puts it on the far right. So, this voltage controls the horizontal deflection of the electron beam. Now, how can we trigger the beam to move back to the left after it reaches the right side of the screen? For that, we can trigger off the level of the voltage. So, let's say we set the trigger level to 102 volts. And again, these numbers are made up. I'm just pulling them out of my...
Oh, don't even go there. That's disgusting.
What? I was just saying I'm pulling them out of my little box right here, which has a bunch of numbers and stuff. What did you think I was gonna say? We'll trigger a horizontal retrace whenever this voltage ramp gets up to or above 102 volts. So, when we send this voltage to our trigger, we can add in the voltage from the horizontal sync pulse. And let's say we're using 5 volts for the horizontal sync pulse. You can see that when we get to 100 volts, and we have a horizontal sync pulse added to that, we get 105 volts. So, we trigger a horizontal retrace, which resets this voltage ramp back to 0 volts. And the negative pulses from the horizontal sync output won't really matter, since they won't trigger the retrace. Now, let's suppose we have a serrated pulse, which means that we have a horizontal sync pulse in the middle, right here. This sync pulse will occur when this voltage ramp reaches 50 volts. When we add them together, we only get up to 55 volts. But this won't be enough to trigger a horizontal retrace, since it needs 102 volts to trigger. Does that make sense? I hope it does. So, that was a quick but more in-depth look at the vertical blanking interval in a composite TV signal. I hope you've enjoyed this little explanation, and hopefully I haven't confused anyone. Please peck at that like button and consider subscribing if you haven't already done so. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time, right here on Dr. Play.